Can 3D printing make more powerful turbines? We'll find out on this episode of the Cool Parts Show.
This episode of the Cool Parts Show is brought to you by Carpenter Additive. The company's Powder Life solution is a combination of hardware and software technologies designed to help AM users manage their metal powders. Stay tuned after the episode for more on how the system works.
I'm Pete.
I'm Stephanie.
Welcome to the Cool Parts Show. This is our show all about unique, amazing, transformative, disruptive, power generating 3D printed parts.
Okay, power generating. You have my attention. What are the parts today?
Okay, the parts today are turbine blades. Turbine, a system for power generation. Basically a big machine using hot pressurized gas to spin a rotating shaft inside of a turbine. There are lots of these blades, maybe hundreds of them, maybe this size, maybe bigger. Today, these blades are made through casting and machining, but there is huge promise, huge potential in getting to make them through additive manufacturing instead. But first, additive has to prove itself.
And since this is the Cool Parts Show, all about cool 3D printed parts, I'm guessing that these blades here have something to do with that, with additive proving itself.
So these blades, they were manufactured for Solar Turbines, turbine manufacturer, and Solar Turbines agreed to run 3D printed turbine blades through their paces within the company's testbed for evaluating stuff like this. The blades were made through additive manufacturing by Oak Ridge National Laboratory in Tennessee at their manufacturing demonstration facility, which is this complex where Oak Ridge helps companies explore, adopt, embrace advanced manufacturing technologies. So yeah, additive had to prove itself. And you look at these from a distance and you wouldn't at a glance necessarily know they were 3D printed. So the first step for 3D printing is just to demonstrate it can reliably make the turbine blades as they are today, as they're designed today. So the geometric freedoms of additive manufacturing off the table for now. Just make the blades as they are. And the material freedom of additive manufacturing. No, for now, prove that we can make it out of the material these blades are made out of right now. So 3D printing proving itself. And so this case, what we're seeing here is kind of additive manufacturing with one hand tied behind its back.
Okay, so 3D printing with one hand behind its back. I kind of like that imagery. So the design is the same as conventional blades, and you said the material is as well. What is the material here?
Inconel 738, nickel-based alloy. The 738 variety of that is one we don't hear about all that much. Within casting, it is kind of a legacy material, but it is the material that these turbine blades are made out of.
Okay, so legacy casting material, existing blade design, but let's talk 3D printing. How are these made?
Electron beam melting. Electron beam melting is a powder bed fusion process that operates at high temperature. It was chosen because of the material, Inconel 738, which is a metal that is prone to stress cracking. And EBM, electron beam melting, offers some power and capability to control against that kind of cracking in the process. And that was the first significant challenge of producing these turbine blades, is assuring a complete 3D printing process in which that kind of cracking never occurs. So let me introduce you to Mike Kirka. He is a research materials scientist at Oak Ridge, and he's been involved with this project all the way through.
From the origins of this program with Solar was a desire to demonstrate that we could use 3D printing and that it was mature enough in terms of materials and technology to be able to rapidly prototype new turbine blade designs. So this is more for the engine design process and evaluation. The challenge that's put forth in this is, can you demonstrate not just one printing of one turbine blade, but entire blade sets while also certifying and qualifying that these materials and geometry that they're safe to enter an engine without having the ability to disintegrate there and cause severe damage. For this project, we use the electron beam melting process over a laser powder bed. And this was due to a number of different factors, one being the ability to manipulate the heat source, the vacuum environment, to keep impurities out, and the heated powder bed of about 1000 C that in the Arcam electron beam melting process, which is not typical found in those of laser powder bed processes. And part of where this becomes important is Inconel 738, which was used in this program, is similar to other casting materials used for turbine blades that are very defect prone, crack just due to thermal stresses on cooling from the liquid to the solid. And, using this ability to have rapid control over the heat source, the electron beam, we are able to suppress a lot of the different thermal gradients that would happen in the parts that would potentially lead to cracking and even them out such that we could process the blades defect free.
Okay, so I'm not a material scientist, but this material sounds like a real pain. So let's just take a step back. Like, why do they want to do this? Why do they want to 3D print these blades out of this material when there are other ways of making them that are potentially easier?
Yeah, and ways that are working now. So why 3D print this? And like, why does 3D printing have to prove itself, right? And the answer is power. Power. And specifically, more efficient generation of power, because we could get to turbines that generate more output for the same size of equipment, just more overall efficiency. And the way to get to that is with heat, with turbines that run hotter. And the way to enable turbines to run hotter is to cool these blades more effectively. And the way to do that is to get more sophisticated internal cooling passages within these blades. And I know your attention perked up when I said that, because that's what additive manufacturing can do. It's really good at capturing complex internal geometry, complicated passages and channels built right into the solid form. So that's what's at stake here, and that's what's on the table, is potentially better performing turbines.
So 3D printing is known for its ability of flexibility design, and the same holds true for turbine blade applications, where you can open up new design paradigms for more efficient cooling schemes or enhanced cooling that would allow turbine blades in the hot section of the engine run much hotter while being able to be cooled. And this would have multiple impacts from, essentially the energy efficiency of the engines themselves, because they can run hotter, to also potentially more resilient components, so they would have longer service lives.
So it sounds like there's a lot of potential opportunity here, and Oak Ridge is on its way to figuring out at least the 3D printing side of this. Are there other challenges that they're working through?
So, this was a big project. So something on the order of 300 turbine blades were 3D printed. I think maybe the precise number was 288. They were built in sets of four in one build volume. And it was just for a long time there. It was build after build after build after build, producing these turbine blades to get enough to do a really comprehensive test. And then once they were done with all of that 3D printing, then came the machining, and the machining took just as long because there were challenges there as well.
So machining is actually, a large part of the 3D printing process. In the case of these turbine blades, similar to as they are cast today, there are critical features such as the fir tree, shrouds, if they're shrouded, cooling channels, and also the pressure sides of the turbine blades that must have critical tolerances, down to micron type precision, because these are mating surfaces that will come into contact with other portions of the engine once they come up to temperature. In the case of the 3D printed turbine blades, machining them was difficult due to a combination of, in the 3D printing process, you have part shrinkage or geometric distortions that happen that can be predicted to a degree, but for one-off type parts, it's a bit more difficult. But then also sort of the lack of thought on the pre-design of datums, or how are you going to fixture the part, and then what are the measurements going to go off for finishing the whole part, especially so in a turbine blade where there's very few perpendicular parallel type surfaces.
So you asked about challenges, and that's one of them. Machining is a significant part of producing these components as well. right now, this phase of the test, the aim was to prove that 3D printing can do the job, that it can make sufficiently strong, high-performing turbine blades, and that was proven, that was demonstrated. But in the future, this idea moves into production, and the design freedom of additive manufacturing can facilitate that production as well. In addition to getting all of these complex internal passages that can realize some of the promise, design elements in additive can also set up the process so that that machining can be a lot easier to do next time around. And maybe that is like locating features that are helpful for machining, or maybe it's like clamping features that help hold it in just the right way for the machine tool. But part of the design freedom and design possibility will be to create an additive manufacturing process that is higher performing as well.
All right, so I think I got this. These are turbine blades that are designed to go into a large power generation turbine. They were 3D printed at the manufacturing demonstration facility at Oak Ridge in collaboration with Solar Turbines. And the idea here was to get 3D printed blades into a power turbine to see if the technology can work in that application. So they used the same existing design for these blades. They used the same legacy casting material, Inconel 738. And the material dictated the 3D printing method here. They used electron beam melting because Inconel is prone to cracking, and that was the best process to try and print them and avoid that cracking. But the machining turned out to be an equal challenge along with the 3D printing, and they had to figure out various things like how to locate these parts in the machine tool. But the real advantage here, if we are able to 3D print blades like this, is the internal geometry. Being able to incorporate better, more advanced, more efficient cooling channels into these blades would allow the turbines to run hotter, to produce energy more efficiently. You get more power out of the same equipment that we already have.
Yeah, totally. So that'll do it. So thank you for watching. Thanks for watching the Cool Parts Show. Check out our earlier episodes, including all of our other electron beam melting EBM episodes, at thecoolpartsshow.com.
If you have a cool part you'd like to tell us about, whether it's literally cooled or not, you can email us at coolparts@additivemanufacturing.media.
If you like the show, leave us a comment, leave us a like, and be sure to subscribe.
Thanks for watching. Thanks again to our sponsor, Carpenter Additive. In addition to supplying metal powders, the company also offers services, software, and hardware to help AM users manage their powder. One example is the Powder Life System, a combination of cloud-based tracking software with hardware designed to make powder handling easier. Two key components are the Powder Life Hopper and the automated docking station. Luke Boyer, manager of Powder Life Applications, and Andrew Holliday, applications engineer, explained how the system works.
So today, when a user of additive manufacturing is receiving powder, they oftentimes receive it in either 5, 10, 15, maybe a 20 kilo bottle. But they're receiving pallets of them, and you're receiving 10, 20, 50, hundreds of these bottles. The user has to look and segregate and store them appropriately so the bottles don't get mixed up. And it requires a lot of lifting and moving and labor.
The components of Powder Life are all based around making powder management systems on the additive manufacturing shop floor easier to use for the operator, cleaner, as well as more traceable. Three of those basic parts of Powder Life are our Powder Life hoppers, or our storage containers for powder. The second would be automated docking systems that allow material to be pushed in and out of machines with no human contact. And the third would be our Powder Life online software system that allows you to trace this powder as it goes through your shop floor.
The hardware, the software together just helps really streamline that and improve the final user's experience and let them concentrate on going from design to the part itself. It takes the headache of powder management out of the equation for them.